What's up, guys? We are Shibuki. So, some of my favorite songs throughout all of history are actually just cover versions of another musician's original material. You Really Got Me by Van Halen, Gary Jules' melancholy and slowed down version of Mad World, Jeff Buckley's Hallelujah, the mind-blowingly powerful reimagining of All Along the Watchtower by Jimi Hendrix, Black Betty by Ram Jam, and how could we possibly leave out that time Johnny Cash decided to take Hurt by Nine Inch Nails and record it so masterfully that most people hear Trent Reznor's version for the first time and wonder why he chose to release such a clearly inferior cover. But we're not here to have a good time today. We're here to subject ourselves to some of the shoddiest and most embarrassing attempts at reincarnating the musical brain children of fellow established artists. So get some toilet paper ready for your earlobes, because you're about to be exposed to some of the worst nuggets of auditory excrement to ever be expelled from your speaker system. Let's do this thing. I forgot that I had more stuff to say before the first clip. So, most of you probably aren't familiar with the name Jose Feliciano, but every single one of you has heard at least one of his songs. He's the guy who wrote
Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad.
So, yeah. People don't really talk about him much anymore, but as the first ever Latin artist to successfully cross over into the English-speaking music mainstream of the Western world, the impact he left on the industry in the wake of his career is undeniable. Fast forward to 2017, and the iconic musician Sting, who is most notable for being a member of The Police, and no, not The Police, The Police, you know, the good ones, has been chosen as one of the recipients of Sweden's prestigious and highly coveted Polar Music Prize. Now, Mr. Feliciano has been graciously invited to perform a musical tribute in his honor, and look, nothing I say could possibly prepare you for what you're about to hear, so sorry in advance. I personally find this one to be the most interesting, because in 99% of the bad covers I came across throughout the course of my research, it was almost exclusively the piss-poor performance of the lead vocalist which rendered it unbearable, but here, it sounds like he's playing a completely different song than everybody else. Maybe he just had a bad start though. Let's see if he redeems himself.
Every breath you take, every move you make, every bond you break, I'll be watching you.
Okay, I didn't realize until about the fifth or sixth time that I subjected myself to this, but Jose Feliciano is blind. So, not only is hearing this guy belt out the words, I'll be watching you, ironic enough, but it also kind of makes me wonder whether Sting simply couldn't help from holding back that disgusted look he has on his face throughout the entirety of the rendition. Or if he just didn't care because he realized that Mr. Feliciano would never know. Anyways, let's start the next clip off with another highly memeable and priceless Sting expression.
You can't see me, my time is now.
Alright, you guys get the gist of it. Vocals bad, guitar bad, everything bad. But the really bizarre thing about the outlandishly poor quality of this performance is that, while Jose did have a few pretty notable original compositions, what actually propelled him into the upper echelon of mainstream stardom was his ability to produce profoundly incredible covers of established rock and roll classics. Like, I'm not even exaggerating. He would take already phenomenal songs from artists such as the Beatles, Michael Jackson, Jimi Hendrix, the Rolling Stones, and Elvis, and absolutely knock it out of the park almost every single time. Just listen to this snippet of his re-envisioning of Light My Fire by the Doors.
You didn't pick up so much fun. I really think you can stay here. They talked about playing the song. So now you get to hear me through. You and me, I hope you die. You and me, I hope you die.
Yeah. Friggin' incredible, right? So I don't really know what happened here. Maybe he was just having an off day or kind of lost his touch in his old age, but regardless, now you guys are going to get to experience the exact moment when I realized that this was instantly going to be promoted to the opening video on my list. Prepare for the weirdest guitar solo you've ever heard in your life.
Keep on crying, baby,
So, first of all, I love pretty much everything about the Smashing Pumpkins. From the dark and somber poetic brilliance of their lyrics, to the complexity of their song arrangements, to that seamless grungy emo blend between alt-hard and pop rock, Billy Corgan's discography is one of the great anthems of my youth. The thing is, though, I kind of put old Billy in the same camp as John McCrea, Johnny Rotten, and Jim Morrison of Cake, the Sex Pistols, and the Doors fame, respectively, in that none of them are actually very good singers in either the technical or traditional sense. They all just kind of possess very specialized and distinct vocal styles, which blend extremely well with the specific type of music they make. And if you're already sitting there with your halfway typed out comment hot in defense of Mr. Corgan, let's see if you still have the balls to press enter after you hear what he did to Landslide by Fleetwood Mac.
Can us help through changing ocean tides? Can I hands up seasons of my life?
You know, the sad thing is, this might not have sounded so bad if they had decided to give it the Smashing Pumpkins treatment and created a higher tempo, heavier, and more electrified version, but good lord, the soft and subdued nature of the backing instrumentals makes the extreme guttural strain behind each individual utterance so much more obvious.
I took my love, I took it down. Climbed a mountain, turned around, and I saw my reflection in a snow-covered hill.
No, Billy! Come on, my dude. You wrote Bullet with Butterfly Wings. You came up with one of the most iconic solo vocal lines of all time. The world is a vampire. Don't drop out all the instruments unless you're gonna nail it, bro. Anyways, I'm gonna end this segment with what I think is, by far, the most pitiful segment of this recreation. The poorly improvised,
mouth noises
that he uses to close out the song. So the 90s was an extremely pivotal period for music. Those upbeat synthesizer-driven hits that dominated every aspect of the decade prior were being phased out to make way for the heavy, powerful distortion and depression-inducing lyrics of the massively influential, albeit short-lived, grunge era, pioneered by bands such as Nirvana and Puddle of Mud. Foreshadowing! White people had finally begun to accept rap and hip-hop as a legitimate form of music, which we can almost exclusively thank Eminem for. And of course, the never-ending barrage of burgeoning boy bands like NSYNC, Boyz II Men, and of course, the Backstreet Boys. Now, while the US was going through its boy band phase, our neighbors across the pond were experiencing the exact same phenomenon, only with all female groups. One of the most notable of these was a musical group based out of London called All Saints, and fair warning, if you happen to be a fan of that Red Hot Chili Peppers song, Under the Bridge, you will never be able to unhear what is about to be wrought upon you. So, if you don't want to have every single version of this song that has ever been recorded ruined forever, I suggest you click off now. Still here? Okay. Don't say I didn't warn you. I hate this intro. It completely misses the point of why the guitar solo at the beginning of this song exists in the first place. The original by John Frusciante is so memorable and iconic because it flows into itself the entire way through and keeps the action going so well that it easily manages to stand alone. Like, playing it like this with those abrupt breaks at the end of every measure is fine once a bit of instrumental accompaniment drops in, but as an independent segment, it just comes across as unsettling and wrong. I don't know. Anyways, let's get to the meat and potatoes, shall we? It's a city. I see what they were going for, and I'm fully confident that an R&B slash hip-hop style revision of this song could have sounded phenomenal, but whatever the hell is going on here is just completely ruining the intended vibe of the original. Also, this is supposed to be like a really sad and introspection-inducing performance. I mean, you're pretty hot or whatever, Blondie Locks, but now is not the appropriate time to look hornier than I've ever seen anybody in my entire life, okay? Here's the last little bit, where it sounds like all of their voices have individually developed sentience and are actively fighting against each other over the role of lead vocalist. Okay, now, this one's a bit different from the rest because William Shatner neither became famous for, nor had any sort of background whatsoever in music. He was actually the actor who portrayed the very first Star Trek captain, James T. Kirk, alongside Leonard Nimoy as Spock, way back in the 60s and 70s. Leonard Nimoy makes music too, by the way, so let me know if you guys would be interested in a video about that, because that's one big hobbit hole in and of itself.
He lives in a hobbit hole and everybody knows him, Bilbo. Bilbo Baggins, he's only 3 feet tall.
Anywho, I don't have to tell you guys who William Shatner is. He's remained consistently relevant for the last 50 years of his life, so just listen to how this dude tries to tackle Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds by the Beatles.
Picture yourself in a boat on a river with tangerine trees and marmalade skies. Somebody calls you. You answer quite slowly. A girl with kaleidoscope eyes.
Bruh. I'm convinced that Billy was deeply internalizing some very powerful feelings of resentment towards some woman in his life at the time, because every single word sounds so happy and sing-songy, except for the word girl.
Newspaper taxis appear on the shore, waiting to take you away. Climb in the back with your head in the clouds, and you're gone!
The music went double time, and he took that as a personal challenge. He said, "The drums think they can just start going twice as fast, huh? Well, I can talk sing at quadruple speed." But honestly, there's not really much more to touch on regarding the musical quality of the song. The entire thing is kind of just more of the same, but I do love how obvious it is that whoever was in charge of editing the video for this was trying really, really hard to replicate the psychedelic style of imagery that was popular at the time, but somehow completely missed the mark in the most r/fellow kids way possible. Like, this piece of art is basically just the musical equivalent of Tommy Wiseau's The Room.
No!
So, Puddle of Mud is a band that first rose to prominence at the dawn of the new millennium with such catchy post-grunge singles as She Effing Hates Me, Psycho, and Control. Now, despite the fact that the band's discography is basically the comfort food of alt-rock, essentially serving as one of those "we have Nirvana at home" memes personified, I actually kind of dig their music. Their lead vocalist and creative center, Wes Scantlin, being well aware of all this and having been receiving comparisons between himself and Kurt Cobain for nearly the entirety of his career, decided to embrace the meme and perform a stripped-down, bare-bones acoustic cover of Nirvana's About a Girl for Sirius XM Radio's copycat version of MTV Unplugged. Another fair warning, though. You might want to pause the video real quick and write out your silly side note, because you are about to laugh yourself to death, so in the words of the late, great Leafius here, play that dog shit. Those faces he's making? Absolutely priceless. Also, I freaking love the fact that every time he sings the line "number two," it looks like he's just reminded himself that a brown cow is peeking out the barnyard door and is trying his best not to shit himself during the performance.
Take it, then it's wild. You hear me out to dry. I can see you every night.
Poor guy. So, according to the band members at least, the reason that Wes Scantlin butchered the performance so badly was because he was actually very sick at the time and suffering from severe congestion, which I'm actually inclined to believe because I went through a big Puddle of Mud phase for a few months back in high school, and not only is this not a very difficult song to sing, but it's also completely compatible with Scantlin's vocal style. Like, all of the other performances on this list basically just boil down to they were trying to do something outside of their range of capability and probably should have just abandoned the idea at the drawing board. But I really do feel like this was more of a victim of circumstance type of situation. No, Wes. You most certainly do not. So, if you guys found this content either entertaining or informative, be sure to hit that like button with a Mick Jagger-style pelvic thrust. Leave a comment down below letting me know what horrendous covers I should include in a potential second video. And subscribe to my channel so that my parents will stop trying to make me get a real job and move out of the basement. It's comfy. I'll catch you mother effing B-words next time, and as always, peace out, Girl Scouts.